Well, good morning, everyone. I'd just like to welcome you all here on this very special day, whether you're joining me here in this room, following us online at this present time, or catching up later. You're all very welcome to be with us this morning. We're going to join together in a moment. Can I please encourage you, if you feel able to join in with the words in bold print as we go through the service. When we come to songs where people stand up, please only do that if you feel comfortably able to do so. If you find it easier to remain seated, then please, that's fine, please do. Our call to worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. There is one body and one spirit. There is one hope to which we were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all. Peace be with you and also with you. If you can comfortably do so, please stand as we sing, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. We have a holy God, And in our human frailty, we don't match his holiness. There are times in our lives, daily, when we fail to walk in his ways. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from every kind of wrong. Let us confess our sins to God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all ends to us, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Let's remember the reassurance Scripture gives us. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us praise God for his mercy, and give thanks to him for his goodness. Open our lips, O Lord, and our mouths shall declare your praise. We stand if we are able to sing, our hope is in life. What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone.
Oh,
Please be seated. Philip.
Hello again. Welcome, everyone. It's good to see you. Late arrivals as well. Very good. I didn't get the memo, I see. Good. Well, welcome if you are watching live stream as well. It's lovely to have you. I expect we've probably got the usual suspects watching online. Yes. Oh, no, that's me, isn't it? Okay, yes. Pauline said she would love to be here, but she's not been very well this week, and so she's watching from next door, which is really nice. But welcome if you're watching on the live stream. Right, we're going to get through these really quickly today. Next. Okay, we've had enough services this weekend. We are not going to have our repeat service at 5 o'clock today. Okay, we're going to lie down in a darkened room, and we're going to rest. Okay, so the repeat service, this service is usually repeated at 5 o'clock. We're not going to do that today. Because we've got the confirmation this afternoon. Next, church family lunch after this service. If you should be booked in, we've got plenty of food, so do stay. Even if you're not booked in, I'm going to cringing as our catering team are going to start throwing things at me, but that's all right. I know we've got plenty of food, so that's fine. Don't worry. If you want to stay, then stay. Good. Next, distinctive. Again, we're not going to have distinctive tonight. All right. I know some of you are going to have family get-togethers after confirmation and stuff like that. So we're not going to have distinctive. Distinctive will kick back into action next week when we're looking at the Shadow King, King David, again next Sunday. Next. PCC tomorrow night. What a joy, the weekend that keeps giving. PCC tomorrow night, 7 o'clock in the barn. We're going to be looking, amongst other things. No, we moved it. We moved it. Oh, we moved it back. Stay at home, have a beer tomorrow night. I got it moved the wrong way, didn't I? Sorry, my fault. All right, this afternoon, that's great. We've got a free evening tomorrow night. Woo, results. Okay, this afternoon, 2 o'clock, here in the hall, we've got confirmation. 8 of our church family are going to be confirmed this afternoon. But not only that, just as an added bonus, we've got 2 baptisms as well. So Eloisa is going to get baptised and Neve is going to get baptised. Where's Neve? Where is she? Neve! We're so excited about you being baptised this afternoon. You as well, Eloisa, but Neve. No. Eloise is getting confirmed as well, so that's really good. This afternoon, 2 o'clock, do hang around after church lunch for confirmation. It's not going to be a mega long service, you'll be pleased to know. Good, next. Bands of marriage. We would have bands of marriage to read today, wouldn't we? Never mind. Good. I publish bands of marriage between Mark Samuel John Lockhart of the parish of Castle Church and Charlotte Louise Dodd, also of the parish of Castle Church. If any of you know cause or just impediments why these persons may not be joined together in holy matrimony, you are to declare it now. Nobody? That's for the second time of asking. Should we just pray for Mark and Charlotte? Lord God, we do pray for Mark and Charlotte as they prepare for their wedding down at St. Mary's. We do pray that you'll transform their married life with the experience of water into wine. And we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Grant, next. Birthdays. Have we got any birthdays? Church family birthday. Oh, my goodness. Right, Scarlett. Who else? Who? Jack. Scarlett, Jack, Ollie. Anybody else? Scarlett, Jack, Ollie. Right, let's sing happy birthday to Scarlett, Jack and Ollie.
Happy
Let's say our birthday prayer for Scott, Jack, Scarlett, Jack, and Ollie. I'll just ignore me. I'll go away. Right, let's pray then, shall we? Lord God, we pray for Scarlett, Jack, and Ollie, and all our church family whose birthdays we now remember with gladness. We pray that they will always remain your special children and may so grow in grace in this life that in the life to come, they may share the joys of heaven. Amen. Good. Now, our Sunday school are going to go out now. You're going to come back in a bit later and watch Ian get ordained. So Sunday school, if you want to go with Emma and John, and toddler Sunday school, go with Tammy. And then I'm going to hand over to Bishop Rod, who's going to switch his radio mic on.
Good. The last one's going off into their special groups. That's wonderful. So good morning, everybody. It's lovely to be here with you. I'm very much looking forward to the lunch afterwards, if you're able to stay on for that. Not just for the food, but just to give me an opportunity to say hello to friends and rejoice together. You may wonder why we've got two bishops. It's not because we need to do a special job on Ian, you know, because there's some doubt about him. It's simply because of arrangements that Church of England makes for churches which believe in the distinctive ministry of men and women, like this one does. And as a result of that, I have a ministry to all those churches that believe those things, so I travel all over the country, including here, but that doesn't in any way diminish your relationship with your own local bishops, and I only operate with their permission. So I just want to say how grateful I am to Bishop Matthew and to his colleague bishops here in the diocese for enabling me to do these sorts of things. And it's going to be a joy to share this service with Bishop Matthew. We're going to be sort of doing bits and pieces of the ordination service. So I'll be doing one bit, then Bishop Matthew, and so on as we go on through. Well, this is obviously a special event for Ian and for his family as well. We rejoice with him at the gifts that God has given him. We're going to be reflecting a little bit more on what role he's called to when we come to the Bible later on. But in the meantime, let me introduce this section of the service with these words. God calls his people to follow Christ and forms us all into a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to declare the wonderful deeds of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvellous light. The church is the body of Christ, the people of God, and the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the whole church is summoned to witness to God's love and to work for the coming of his kingdom. To serve this royal priesthood, God has given particular ministries. Presbyters are ordained to lead God's people in the offering of praise and the proclamation of the gospel. They share with the bishop in the oversight of the church, delighting in its beauty and rejoicing in its well-being. They are to set the example of the good shepherd always before them as the pattern of their calling. With the bishop and their fellow presbyters, they are to sustain the community of the faithful by the ministry of word and sacrament, that we all may grow into the fullness of Christ and be a living sacrifice, acceptable to God.
Bishop Rod, I present Ian to be ordained to the office of presbyter in the Church of God and to serve in this parish.
Have those whose duty it is to know Ian and examine him found him to be of godly life and sound learning?
They have.
Do they believe him to be duly called to serve God in this ministry?
They do.
Ian, do you believe that God is calling you to this ministry?
I do so believe.
I invite Jeanette to confirm that Ian has taken the necessary oaths and made the declaration of assent.
He has duly taken the oath of allegiance to the sovereign and the oath of the canonical obedience to the bishop. He has affirmed and declared his belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness.
So let us pray for Ian and for the ministry of the whole people of God. God our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son you have called into the fellowship of your universal Church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry, each may be an instrument of your love, and give to your servant now to be ordained the needful gifts of grace, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
We say together the prayer for illumination. God of mercy, you promised never to break your covenant with us. Amid all the changing words of our generation, speak your eternal word that does not change. Then may we respond to your gracious promises with faithful and obedient lives. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our reading this morning comes from the first of Peter's letters to the early church, equally applicable to us, full of wisdom, advice, and encouragement. If you wish to follow it in the church Bibles, it's on page 1220. First letter of Peter, chapter 5, verse 1. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, a witness of Christ's sufferings, and one who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power for ever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
For Bishop God brings God's word to us, let's stand if we're able and sing together for the break in the door.
Rock the grave, God the Lord, save us.
Please be seated. So as we turn back to the scripture that was read for us earlier, shall we pray that the Holy Spirit himself helps us to understand what it's saying? Heavenly Father, we ask that as we turn to your word again, that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher and guide this morning. And please help us to apply the truths that we see here. And we pray particularly for Ian, as he's ordained this morning, that he will himself be listening to this passage addressed to elders amongst us, and will be blessed thereby, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, you'll have gathered from my prayer just now that this passage has been chosen because it's addressed to the elders among you, the presbyters among you. It's got a lot to say, but before we get to that point, it's probably worth us just catching up with what Peter's been writing in his first letter, because he wrote this letter to Christians who had been dispersed across a large area of the ancient world and whose normal support structures had disappeared. So they were in real danger, not danger physically necessarily, but danger of capitulating to the cultures around them, ending up living just like others and therefore forgetting that God had made them his distinctive people and had plans for them. Now, we might think that this is a very ancient text, but of course, as soon as we put it like that, we can see how it's relevant to us today. We too see vast movements of people across the world as they move into exile for one reason or another. And having gone through the pandemic as we have, now that restrictions are easing, we look back on a time where, for many of us, the normal support structures disappeared. We were asking ourselves question about where God was in all of this, and what it meant for us. And we felt sort of as though we'd been loosed from our moorings in some ways. So our experience then wasn't that different in some ways to the experience that these ancient Christians were going through. And we all know the pressure on us to compromise with the world around and to share the values of the world around, don't we? Rather than be distinctive people of God, because we face those pressures every day. And Peter's antidote to this, Peter's encouragement to God's people to be his distinctive people, and one of the big messages of his letter is this: remember the extraordinary glory that one day we're going to experience as God's distinctive people. And as we remember what God is calling us to, that will help us to be distinctive and holy here and now, as a response to what we're looking forward to. So by the time we get to chapter 5, the particular aspect of distinctiveness for God's people that the apostle is concentrating on is this one. It's humility. So what we're going to discover as we go through this chapter is we're going to see the link between being humble and the hope that we have. I said that in the light of the hope, we live distinctively now, and so we'll see that link between humility and hope as we go through. So first of all, let's look at Peter. Hope and humility in Peter himself. So in verse 1, Peter exhorts the elders among you as a fellow elder. He doesn't exhort them as an apostle, but just as a fellow elder. So right at the start, there's this lovely mark of humility. He could have said, as an apostle, I require this and that of you. But no, he appeals as a fellow elder. That word elder, by the way, it's a word that's interchangeable in the New Testament with the word overseer. So when you read elder and when you read overseer, they're both from the same root. Philip Hacking in Sheffield used to illustrate this interchangeability between elder and overseer when he said that in Scotland there's a weed called Bishop's Weed, but in Lancashire exactly the same weed is known as Creeping Elder. Neither of them terribly flattering descriptions, are they? So Peter starts humbly by saying he's just another elder. But then he says he's a witness of the sufferings of Christ. I appeal to you as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ. And that's a very poignant phrase for him to say, isn't it? In view of the fact that as Christ was suffering, Peter denied that he had anything to do with him, and he did so three times. But Jesus Christ himself, when he rose from the dead, restored Peter. And so Peter can say with complete assurance that he's got this amazing hope. He's going to be a partaker in the glory that's going to be revealed, end of verse 1, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. And that's why he's so marked by humility. He knows he doesn't deserve it. I mean, he's let Christ down in a big way at a crucial moment. He failed the test. But the Lord picked him up and still held this wonderful hope ahead for him. So all of this has come to Peter by the Lord Jesus himself showing him mercy. And meantime, the Lord has given him a job to do, that of feeding the sheep. So that is going to be revealed. Verse 2, shepherd the flock of God that is among you. That was the job that Peter was given. So in the light of this great hope, the humility that he's got is a sign of the great work of grace in his life, and he's now got a job to do. Well, there are many ways in which we can show humility, aren't there? Many ways it shows in people's lives, the way they listen to others rather than talk about themselves, their willingness to take on the unpopular tasks rather than those which will earn them glowing reports. But I think the one thing that I'd like to point out this morning is that our humility is shown most of all in the way we pray. Because after all, when we pray, we show that we're entirely dependent on the strength of God and the power of God to invest our efforts with any sort of outcome at all. It is entirely his doing. So we come to him in prayer, and that act of praying is an acknowledgement in humility that we don't have the ability to deliver great spiritual breakthroughs. Only God can do that. Apparently, the story is told of D.L. Moody, when the great American evangelist of the 19th century. He came to England and was asked whether he had heard Charles Spurgeon preaching, because Charles Spurgeon was a great preacher in this country in those days. Charles Spurgeon preached before millions. He had his sermons circulated across continents, and he trained up an army of pastors. So he was, you know, extremely well known for his preaching. But when D.L. Moody was asked the question after he first visited, did you hear Spurgeon preach? He replied, yes, but better still, I heard him pray. So it's in prayer that we acknowledge our need before God and cast ourselves on his mercy. Well, first then, hope and humility in Peter. He knows he didn't deserve it. Now, secondly, hope and humility in the congregation. And that's verses 5 to 11. Verses 5 to 11. So this is addressed to the congregation. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility towards one another. Verse 6, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time he may exalt you. And the reason why the congregation as a whole is told to be humble is exactly the same as for Peter. It's so that God's grace can be poured into our lives. Clothe yourselves with humility, says Peter in verse 5, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now, it's worth thinking about that, isn't it? Have you ever been, to a restaurant or dinner or something like that, where you're happily drinking a glass of water or a glass of wine, and the person sitting next to you says, "Oh my goodness, have you tried this wine?" You look at it and you think, "Well, it's not what I'm drinking." And he's clearly deeply impressed by it. So, you look around for a suitable pot plant that you can tip your whatever's in your glass into. And then you take this delicious wine and you have it. Now, it hasn't happened to me very often, but it has happened to me once. And the fact is that before you can experience this great stuff, you've got to get rid of what was there. And it's exactly the same for us. We have to empty ourselves of all our own selfishness. We have to empty ourselves of ourselves so that we can be filled with God's grace. After all, if we are full of ourselves, there's no room for his grace to be poured in. Now, that's the principle, but of course, it's one thing to sort of explore that, but quite another to apply it in our lives. And the particular application that Peter had to think about was the suffering that these people were experiencing. So you read about that in verse 9. "Resist him," that's the devil, "firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world." Now, why is it difficult to be humble in the face of suffering? It bears thinking about, doesn't it? Just have a think about what happens when you suffer, whether it's through health or whether it's at the hands of another person or whatever it may be. You're experiencing suffering, and what's your natural reaction? Well, one thing is to say, "Why is God letting me go through this?" And then sometimes we follow up with, "Doesn't God care?" And do you see what we're doing? We're starting to put ourselves in the position of being judges of God. God shouldn't be doing this. He should be doing something else. He's letting me down. And Peter says, "Be humble. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God." Because God has his reasons. Now, we don't always know what those reasons are, do we? Which is why it's difficult to humble yourselves. But Peter says, no, humble yourselves. Because God is sovereign. And we don't know what his reasons might be. There are sometimes ways in which God gets through to us in suffering that he doesn't get through to us in other times of life. Sometimes we particularly experience his strength or his assurance that he's with us. Or sometimes when he's stripped loads of things out of our lives that we used to think were really important, what are we left with? And we suddenly realise all we're left with is God. Well, I don't know what the reasons may be, but I do know that it's a challenge to our humility. And yet if we want to experience the grace of God, we have to empty ourselves. So hope and humility in Peter, hope and humility in the congregation. And then thirdly, and this is where we come to Ian, hope and humility in elders, in presbyters. I've gone out of order in what I've said about this passage so far, because I want to come back as we finish to verses 1-4. This is where the whole emphasis of the chapter is. So Peter has words of exhortation for elders like Ian. And the reason why he's exhorting them particularly is you don't get it in the translation that's been circulated in your order of service. But actually, when you look at the original text, you see that chapter 5 starts with the word "so." In other words, it links what Peter's saying to the elders with what has just gone before. And what has just gone before is that Peter has said it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. Now that's a quotation from the Old Testament book of Ezekiel, where God's judgment came on people who had moved away from him, and it started with the priests in the temple. That's where his judgment was first felt. And so Peter says, so, I exhort the elders among you. They are the ones with special responsibility for leading God's people. And in view of the fact that they have that responsibility, Peter exhorts them. And he exhorts them to shepherd or oversee the flock in three distinctive ways. First, they are to shepherd them willingly, not under compulsion. Because doing so, of course, is a great sign of a recognition that they themselves have received astonishing grace in their lives. Now, I have to say, it's not always easy to do that as a licensed minister in the Church of England, because, you know, I was saying this yesterday at the ordination that we did in Audley, that, you know, we are paid to care for people. We're paid to exercise our ministries. We're required to, you know, look after our professional development, and we're helped to do that. And all of those sorts of things are helpful, but they can at the end of the day reduce this to the idea of it just being an occupation. It's what I do. And sometimes you can get a bit resentful. Well, I'm not paid to do all that. You know, I remember the story that I was told of a vicar who was desperately trying to keep a day off in his week. And he started this lovely system of having a day off that he publicised to his congregation so that they should know that there's one day when they won't be able to reach him. He has his day off. So he starts his day off, and lo and behold, 10 o'clock in the morning, the front doorbell rings, and he goes down, and there's an elderly member of the congregation saying, asking if the vicar would take her to the shops in his car. And she said, I've come today because I knew you wouldn't be busy. Now, there are times when, you know, that sort of thing can be a bit trying. And we can say to ourselves, well, that's not what I'm here for. But, yes, I know, this is not a particularly pointed message at anyone. But can I just say that Peter says to them, that to the elders among you, shepherd willingly, not under compulsion. Why? Because we ourselves have received this great gift from God, this great prospect of being with him forever in a situation where there is nothing that will damage that relationship with him, where there is no more compromise and there is no more pain and there is no more suffering. And I don't have to continue to doubt myself and all of those things. No, as a free gift, God has given us membership of his family forever, life to the full forever. And none of us deserve it. None of us deserve it. And to the elders among you, in particular, it's good to demonstrate that what we do is willingly, not because we must, but because we ourselves have received this tremendous free gift. So, shepherd willingly, not under compulsion. Secondly, they are to shepherd not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not for shameful gain. I used to wonder how that applied to Church of England clergy, because I wasn't particularly aware that we went into it for the money. You know, stipend's adequate, but not necessarily, you know, likely to be the main motivation for doing it. But then I thought about how sometimes there are things that we do seek to gain in ministry if we're not careful. Some people seek to gain a reputation and therefore, you know, want to be seen at the right events and speaking at the right events and doing those sorts of things. Some people want to be able to demonstrate success in their ministries, you know, in all sorts of different ways. Some people do actually go after money, one way or another, you know, searching for those things that would be particularly fee-paying or whatever. But Peter says, no, look, Don't let's be going for things for those sorts of reasons. Rather, let's be eager to do the thing. In other words, we'd do it if money wasn't involved. We'd do it if recognition wasn't involved. Because doing it is such a privilege. We're working together with God on this wonderful ministry of alerting people to the free gift that God gives to all who turn to Christ in faith. So shepherd, not for shameful gain, but eagerly. And then thirdly, not domineering, not lording it over people was the translation we had. Not domineering, but being examples. Now, you know, as evangelicals, we do need to take that teaching seriously, don't we? We do need to take that seriously because in the last couple of years, there have been all sorts of scandals amongst evangelicals within the Church of England where people have sought to move people on in holy living, not by encouraging them through the scriptures necessarily, but by making demands on them, by being domineering, by controlling behaviour, by coercive means, by making people feel bad unless they do certain things, by seeking to enforce certain things. And actually, if you've lost patience as a teacher because, you know, people don't seem to be responding fast enough or whatever, you know, you can understand why you're anxious to move people on, and therefore you can start to become domineering and lording it over people, not because of your position, but because you want to see things change. And Peter says, don't be like that. Don't be domineering people. After all, we follow the example of Christ, who was gentle and humble in heart. We're told frequently in the New Testament to teach patiently, because with any sort of teaching, it takes a long time for lessons to go in. So teach patiently. And we're not to be people who domineer, but rather to set examples of humility and patience as we wait for the Holy Spirit's work in people's lives, rather than telling the Holy Spirit how quickly he should be working. And then, look at the hope. Verse 4, when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Can you imagine that? Recognition from the chief shepherd of having faithfully shepherded God's people. So how can elders be encouraged to display the humility Peter talks about? Well, by being reminded that there would be nothing better than to have the chief shepherd say, well done. Hope and humility, they're inextricably linked for all of us because of God's grace. Well, shall we pray that that is so for us all? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this message in 1 Peter, this reminder to both elders but also congregations of the need for us to show humility in our lives, not because we must, but because of we becoming so aware of what you have made possible for us, the hope you give us in our life through the work of your Holy Spirit and because of all that Jesus achieved for us. Heavenly Father, we recognize that we don't deserve any of your goodness towards us. We've done nothing to restore the relationship that we've broken with you whenever we've turned away from you. And yet, knowing that we are incapable of doing that, you sent your Son to die for us. Thank you, Father, for that free gift of restoring us to be members of your family and giving us hope for the future. Help us to live in humility with one another because of how much we have been given. We ask this in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, as we now return to the process of ordaining Ian, we're first of all going to remind ourselves of what it is that unites the whole Church of God, and as we stand to say together the words of the Creed. So if you're able, but not if you're not, please stand. And we say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please would you be seated, and Ian is coming forward. Presbyters are called to be servants and shepherds among the people to whom they are sent. With their bishop and fellow ministers, they are to proclaim the word of the Lord and to watch for the signs of God's new creation. They are to be messengers, sentinels, and stewards of the Lord. They are to teach and to admonish, to feed and provide for his family, to search for his children in the wilderness of this world's temptations, and to guide them through its confusions, that they may be saved through Christ forever. Formed by the word, they are to call their hearers to repentance and to declare in Christ's name the absolution and forgiveness of their sins. With all God's people, they are to tell the story of God's love. They are to baptize new disciples in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and to walk with them in the way of Christ, nurturing them in the faith. They are to unfold the Scriptures, to preach the word in season and out of season, and to declare the mighty acts of God. They are to preside at the Lord's table and lead his people in worship, offering with them a spiritual sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. They are to bless the people in God's name. They are to resist evil, support the weak, defend the poor, and intercede for all in need. They are to minister to the sick and prepare the dying for their death. Guided by the Spirit, they are to discern and foster the gifts of all God's people, that the whole church may be built up in unity and faith.
Ian, we trust that long ago you began to weigh and ponder all this, and that you are fully determined, by the grace of God, to devote yourself wholly to his service, so that as you daily follow the rule and teaching of our Lord and grow into his likeness, God may sanctify the lives of all with whom you have to do. And now, in order that we may know your mind and purpose, you must make the declarations we put to you. Do you accept the Holy Scriptures as revealing all things necessary for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ?
I do so accept them.
Will you be diligent in prayer, in reading Holy Scripture, and in all studies that will deepen your faith and fit you to bear witness to the truth of the gospel.
By the help of God, I will.
Will you lead Christ's people in proclaiming his glorious gospel, so that the good news of salvation may be heard in every place?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you faithfully minister the doctrine and sacraments of Christ as the Church of England has received them, so that the people committed to your charge may be defended from against error and flourish in their faith?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you, knowing yourself to be reconciled to God in Christ, strive to be an instrument of God's peace in the church and in the world?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you endeavour to fashion your own life and that of your household according to the way of Christ, that you may be a pattern and example to Christ's people?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you work with your fellow servants in the gospel for the sake of the kingdom of God?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you accept and minister the discipline of this church and respect authority duly exercised within it?
By the help of God, I will.
Will you then, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, continually stir up the gift of God that is in you to make Christ known among all whom you serve?
By the help of God, I will.
I'm hoping for enthusiastic and rafter-raising responses to these questions. Brothers and sisters, you have heard how great is the charge that Ian is ready to undertake, and you have heard his declarations. Is it now your will that he should be ordained?
Yes.
Will you continually pray for him?
We will.
Will you uphold and encourage him in his ministry?
We will.
Thank you. Ian, in the name of our Lord, we bid you to remember the greatness of the trust that is now to be committed to your charge. Remember always with thanksgiving that the treasure now to be entrusted to you is Christ's own flock, bought by the shedding of his blood on the cross. It is to him that you will render account for your stewardship of his people. You cannot bear the weight of this calling in your own strength, but only by the grace and power of God. Pray, therefore, that your heart may daily be enlarged and your understanding of the scriptures enlightened. Pray earnestly for the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Cause your words to come.
Let us pray. These prayers for Ian are based on 2 Timothy chapter 4. Paul writes in verse 2, "Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction." Lord God, we pray for Ian on this, his ordination day. We pray that he would be a faithful preacher of your word. We ask that you would help him to commit to regular daily study of the Bible so that he will be built up personally in his own faith and be thoroughly prepared in and out of season to undertake the vital task of teaching us, your people, here at Castle Church. We pray that he would be bold in his preaching, correcting, rebuking, and encouraging with great patience and careful instruction. We ask this in your name. Amen. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. Heavenly Father, we live now in an age when men do not accept sound doctrine. We pray that during his ministry, Ian will stay utterly grounded in the truth of your word, firmly fixed on the doctrine which is revealed in the Bible. We thank you for the firm foundations he received from his former churches. We thank you for his training at Oak Hill, for all that he learned there, and for the experience he has gained in the last year here at Castle Church. We pray that as he moves forward in ministry, he will grow in his love for you and remain firmly rooted in his faith. We pray that he would never be tempted to preach to itching ears, but would speak the truth of your word. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Paul writes, "But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry." Lord God, we pray that you would sustain Ian in his ministry. When necessary, we pray that he would be able to keep his head, and when suffering comes, especially suffering for the sake of the gospel. We pray that he would be able to endure hardships, relying on you to sustain him through all times. We pray that he would be an effective evangelist, clearly proclaiming the gospel of justification by faith through grace. We pray that he would be faithful in discharging all the duties of his ministry, pointing people to you and giving you the glory in everything. Amen. And verse 7, Paul writes, "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Lord Jesus, we pray that we would all be able to fight the good fight, keep the faith, and cross the finish line into glory. We thank you for the wonderful promise of heaven and a crown of righteousness for those who are yours. We thank you that you are the righteous judge who will declare us not guilty on that day because of the blood of Jesus. We pray that during his ministry, by your grace and mercy, Ian will always run the straight race with his eyes fixed on you and the promise of the heavenly reward. We ask all these prayers through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus. Amen.
So we move now to the ordination itself, and we remain in a posture of prayer. We praise and glorify you, Almighty Father, because in your infinite love you have formed throughout the world a holy people for your own possession, a royal priesthood, a universal church. We praise and glorify you because you have given us your only Son, Jesus Christ, the image of your eternal and invisible glory, the firstborn of all creation and head of the church. We praise and glorify you that by his death he has overcome death, and that having ascended into heaven, he's given his gifts abundantly to equip your holy people for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. And now we give you thanks that you've called this your servant, Ian, whom we ordain in your name, to share as a presbyter in the ministry of the gospel of Christ, the apostle and high priest of our faith, and the shepherd of our souls. Therefore, Father, through Christ our Lord, we pray. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Ian for the office and work of a presbyter in your church, Through your Spirit, Heavenly Father, give this your servant grace and power to proclaim the gospel of your salvation and minister the sacraments of the new covenant. Renew him in holiness and give him wisdom and discipline to work faithfully with those committed to his charge. In union with his fellow servants in Christ, may he reconcile what is divided, heal what is wounded, and restore what is lost. May he declare your blessings to your people. May he proclaim Christ's victory over the powers of darkness and absolve in Christ's name those who turn to him in faith. So shall a people made holy in Christ offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you, our God and Father, to whom with the Son and the Holy Spirit belong glory and honour, worship and praise, now and for ever.
Amen.
Ian, receive this book as a sign of the authority which God has given you this day to preach the gospel of Christ and to minister his holy sacraments.
God in Christ reconciling the world to himself and has given us this ministry of reconciliation.
We welcome you as ambassadors for Christ.
Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly.
Great.
Ordain you today, Ian, and I know that as you have been a blessing to this congregation, you will continue to be, and to your family as well. Thank you very much indeed. We're going to sing about the wonderful gifts that God has given us in Christ, wonderful grace that gives what I don't deserve, and that is going to, as we sing that, help us prepare for our time of communion as we break bread. Take bread and wine and remember afresh all that Jesus Christ sacrificed for us, and this will be our spiritual union with him as we eat and drink. Wonderful grace that gives what I don't deserve.
Thank you.
seated. Our dear friends and brothers and sisters who constitute this congregation of Jesus Christ, the Lord has prepared his table for all who love him and trust in him alone for their salvation. This is not a table of merit, it is a table of grace. All who are truly sorry for their sins, who sincerely believe in the Lord Jesus as their Saviour, and who desire to live in obedience to him as their Lord, are now invited to come with gladness to the table of the Lord. So lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give thanks and praise.
With joy we praise you, gracious God, for you have created heaven and earth, made us in your image and kept covenant with us, even when we fell into sin. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whose grace we may triumph over temptation, be more fervent in prayer, and be more generous in love. Therefore we join our voices with all the company of heaven and all your creation to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to God the Father that our Saviour Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this remembrance of his sacrifice until he comes again. At his Last Supper, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We proclaim our faith as signed and sealed in this sacrament, as we declare together,
"Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again."
We say together this prayer of humble access.
We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord,
trusting in our own righteousness,
but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature we always have had mercy.
Grant us therefore, gracious Lord,
so to eat flesh of your dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
We who are many are one body, for we all share the same bread.
The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
The blood that we drink is our participation in the blood of Christ.
So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving. the Lord's death and all that he gives to us through his grace. And as by eating bread and drinking wine, we are displaying our union with him and with one another, and we say together the prayer he taught us to say. Our Father,
hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And we say, Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, and you have fed us the spiritual food in the sacraments of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love us to serve you with gladness and singleness of our heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our closing song, I Know That My Redeemer Lives, words of Job. Despite all the difficulties he faced, he knew where his hope lay.
Let's sit down, shall we?
Thank you.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.